Hi, let's talk about the ear. So the ear, as you recall, has three divisions. There's an outer ear, a middle ear, and an inner ear. The outer ear is the external acoustic meatus, and all of the space that's occupied lateral to the tympanic membrane, or the eardrum. So in this cartoon, in the lower left-hand corner, this is an anterior view of the middle ear. We can see the tympanic membrane here. So that would be the outer ear. This space is the middle ear, and that space that is within the middle ear is called the tympanic cavity. And so the tympanic membrane, or the eardrum, is on the lateral wall. Here is the roof, or the tegum tympani. And then this is the medial wall. And the medial wall is going to be contiguous with the inner ear. And sound is conducted through the middle ear ossicles to the inner ear. And I think that having this this cartoon is going to be helpful for us as we look at the cadaveric images here. So what we're looking at is a medial view of the lateral wall. So we are looking from the medial wall towards the outer ear. And so here is the tympanic membrane, and beyond that tympanic membrane would be the outer ear. The malleus, at least the handle of the malleus there, is inserted on that tympanic membrane such that when the tympanic membrane vibrates, the malleus is going to vibrate. The malleus connects to the incus, which we can see here. And here's part of the head of the malleus. So this particular temporal bone has been cut in half, and the remainder of that temporal bone has been removed. So the stapes has been removed. Now there are a couple of interesting features to see here. So running anteriorly from this, you can see along there, that's part of the pharyngotympanic tube. Also known as the eustachian tube or the auditory tube. So this passageway is going to lead from the middle ear to the nasopharynx. And so this is a means by which pressure can equilibrate between the nasopharynx and the middle ear. Now, just superior to this, and we can't see it because it's somewhat obstructed, but the canal is right about there. There's a muscle called the tensor tympani muscle. And the belly of that muscle is within the canal that's running parallel to the pharyngotympanic tube. Coming out of this passageway is going to be the tendon for tensor tympani, and it's going to insert itself on the handle of the malleus. And so having this tensor tympani here is useful for helping to deaden any loud sounds so as to protect hearing. Tensor tympani is innervated by branches of V3. And I always remember that V3 innervates tensor tympani because I feel like people carry a lot of tension in their jaw, in their mandible. And so that's, the area that is innervated both afferently and a lot of the efferent muscles, the muscles of mastication. And so anything with this tensor in the name, like tensor tympani, is a V3 target. There's also a nerve here, chorda tympani, and this is a classic anatomical relationship that we see here of chorda tympani. And so what's going on is the facial nerve, which we cannot see here, cranial nerve 7, enters into the internal acoustic meatus with cranial nerve 8, the vestibulocochlear nerve, and then it enters into the facial canal of the temporal bone. This is the longest osseous canal that contains a nerve in the skull. And one of the branches that facial nerve gives off is chorda tympani. Chorda tympani traverses the tympanic cavity and it runs between the malleus and the incus. And so you can find chorda tympani there. Now, the interesting thing about chorda tympani is then it leaves the skull through the petrotympanic fissure. And at that point, it's inside the infratemporal fossa. Now, it joins up with the lingual nerve, which is a branch of V3. And so chorda tympani fibers are hitchhiking on the lingual nerve. And these fibers are twofold important. One, they're carrying preganglionic parasympathetic fibers. So preganglionic parasympathetic fibers to the submandibular ganglion. That submandibular ganglion, if you recall, serves the submandibular gland and the sublingual glands. Chorda tympani is also carrying special sensory fibers for taste that are bound for the anterior tongue. So it's making its way through the middle ear at this point. And we should all see it here. We talked about chorda tympani and in the infratemporal fossa, we talked about it when discussing the salivary glands and the oral cavity and the submandibular triangle. So we may as well also see it here early on in its journey. So turning our attention to the basic cranium. So let's see. Here is the mastoid process. There's the styloid process, just so we can orient ourselves. And just anteromedial to where that stylomastoid foramen would be, if we kind of head that way, we can see the opening, we can see that over here, for the carotid canal. It's difficult to see here, but we can also see the openings for the internal jugular vein, so the jugular foramina. It might be best to look over here on this skull that's somewhat canted. So there's foramen magnum, there are the occipital condyles. So that way is anterior, that way is posterior. And so there is the carotid canal. Here is the jugular fossa. And if we were to continue, the jugular foramen. And between the two, look at this tiny little thing. That is the tympanic canaliculus. Tympanic canaliculus. And this is going to be an important osteological part of the journey of preganglionic parasympathetic fibers on their way from the glossopharyngeal nerve, cranial nerve number 9, through the middle ear, through the skull out into the infratemporal fossa to synapse in the otic ganglion. So let's take a look here at the medial wall, also called the labyrinthine wall, and some of those structures. So anterior is this direction, posterior is this direction, and one thing that we can note posteriorly is that this is very cancellous. Lots of space here. And the sum total of all of this space are the mastoid air cells. So within the mastoid process, it's very cancellous, all of these open spaces, and those spaces are contiguous with the middle ear. We can actually get to them through the posterior wall here. So again, we're looking at this wall, and let's point out some of the structures that we can see here. So anteriorly, again, we have part of this. We've got a little bit of the pharyngotympanic tube. So this isn't really on the medial wall. This would be more of an anterior wall, but we can see part of it because this has been sectioned. We can also see, this is pretty prominent here. We could see the tympanic nerve rising up onto the promontory here. And then branching out into the tympanic plexus, and then it's going to continue. So that tympanic nerve is a branch of glossopharyngeal. Glossopharyngeal nerve, as you recall, is going to exit through the jugular foramen, 9, 10, and 11. Glossopharyngeal, vagus, and accessory. When glossopharyngeal exits this, it's heading out, the tympanic nerve enters that tympanic canaliculus. Okay, so now it's heading superiorly. It goes over the promontory. That promontory, remember, the medial wall of the middle ear is going to be against the inner ear. So the promontory is actually a little outbutting of bone formed by a portion of the cochlea. So coming out of that tympanic plexus is the lesser petrosal nerve. That lesser petrosal nerve is going through the tegum tympani, the roof of the middle ear. It's going across the basic cranium, and it's going to dive down through foramen ovale, where those preganglionic parasympathetic fibers are going to meet the otic ganglion. All right, now, just posterior to the promontory, we can see another ossicle. So there is the stapes. The stapes is sitting with its foot plate in the oval window. So it's conducting those vibrations, those sound vibrations, to the oval window. And then that is being conducted in the middle ear. Below the oval window, we have the round window. That round window is a membranous part of the wall of the middle ear, the medial wall, and that allows for some expansion of the otolymph within the cochlea. Now there's also a muscle attached from the posterior wall to the neck of the stapes, and we can't see that muscle, unfortunately, here. It's not present in this particular image, but we can see here, there's the stapedius muscle going out to the neck of the stapes. Stapedius muscle is innervated by the facial nerve. So within the canal, in addition to the greater petrosal nerve, which is given off in the canal. Those are preganglionic parasympathetic fibers bound for the trigopalatine ganglion and the chorda tympani. There's also a nerve to the stapedius muscle, which is facial. And sometimes with Bell's palsy, it's very rare, but sometimes with Bell's palsy, a person can suffer from hyperacusis because the stapedius muscle has been denervated. All right, we have another view of the medial wall, and this is just to reinforce the round window for the footplate of the stapes, and I'm sorry, the oval window, and the round window that would be inferior to it. So, promontory with tympanic plexus, tympanic nerve going in, lesser petrosal nerve coming out, oval window, round window. And then finally we come to the the inner ear. So the inner ear, pardon me, is surrounded by bone. And we can see that there are two large bony elements here. There's a third, which is the vestibule, but we can see this snail-shaped cochlea. The cochlea is the site for our auditory sense, for hearing. And we also have three semicircular canals. And these semicircular canals, pardon me, are oriented in a posterior, horizontal, and superior position. And these correspond to pitch, roll, and yaw axes. And so these are full of endolymph with hair cells. And so as the head turns and there's motion, the endolymph moves and it triggers hair cells. And you can detect which way you're moving in these pitch, roll, and yaw axes in these various rotary movements. Now the special sensory fibers that are innervating the inner ear are complements of cranial nerve 8, the vestibulocochlear nerve. And so vestibulocochlear nerve is entering in through the internal acoustic meatus, and this is of the petrous portion of the temporal bone. So if we look here, that's the petrous portion of the temporal bone. We've got a nice ridge here, and that ridge has a face going down, and that internal acoustic meatus is on the lateral surface of that face. So here's the ridge, looking at this from a different angle. So there's anterior. There's posterior, so this is an odd axis, but right there is the internal acoustic meatus. And it's through that that we get the facial nerve and the vestibulocochlear nerve. So 7 and 8 are going in through that space. So we've talked about the ear, the outer ear, the middle ear, and the inner ear, and various features, especially of the middle ear and inner ear. I thank you for your time.